By learning to draw the subject of today's show, you will actually be making the world a safer place. I know, pretty heavy statement. But today we'll be drawing comic book heroes. Hi, I'm Bruce Blitz, and welcome to Cartooning with Blitz. And speaking of comic book art, for our feature of the day, we'll be going to the International Museum of Cartoon Art in Boca Raton, Florida, to interview the Grand Master of comic book art, Mr. Will Eisner. And he'll be our special guest today. He's great. And for our doodle trick, hand and feet cartoons. That's all I can tell you about that. You've got to stay tuned to see what I'm talking about. Now, for our first superhero today, we'll draw Hero Gal. And I'm not going to use pencil for this. I'm going to go directly to marker with bold, right-to-the-point lines. Are you ready? It's going to be a side view. Let's go. And we'll start with that little point right there, because that tells me that's the bridge of her nose, and that's my starting point. Hey, everybody's got to start somewhere, right? And there's her nose, and here's her nostril, and now her lip, which is going to be smiling, and a lot of teeth. She's very confident, and a big smile like that. And notice how I'm not connecting all the lines. You don't have to. Now, here's her cheek. Very strong as well. Now, she's got a strong chin, but delicate. In other words, it's got like sharp angles to it, but it's not very large. Okay, now up here, we'll draw her eye. And that's a heavy line because that's the line that's got the eyelashes on it, and the other one's a little bit lighter, as you see. And let's put her eye in there. And you see that most of the eye is tucked underneath that eyelid line, isn't it? Now let's make her eyelid a little bit like that. And some big eyelashes. And you can take it to the max because it's a comic book hero. And I'm going to bear down a lot and get a real heavy eyebrow. Okay, now she's a superhero. Let's give her some accessories, like maybe a headband and some detail in there. Now I'm going to switch to my larger point marker and do some hair. And I'm going to give her a real fluffy, wild hair because she's always flying. And let's see, come back here a lot. Remember, you always want to make it large enough in the back. A lot of beginners want to make that line come down here, and you don't want to do that. Now right here, let's make a swirly that could be like an earring. And here's some hair coming down, and here's her neck. That's her jawline. And again, I'm not connecting that. And let's see, here's her cape. And here's her arm. And let's fill in the rest of that hair coming down. And she looks great. Now I'm going to add some color. Now, you know what I like best about comic books? I like the issues that you buy that explain the origin of that character, you know, where they got their superpowers. That's interesting to me. And the good thing about creating your own characters is you get to create your superheroes with their powers, and you decide what they get to do, everything. Let's put some red in here for her lips. And let's see, okay, some purple. How about some purple for her headband? And let's make her color coordinated. Let's have her outfit the same way. And her arms back here. Okay, now for the hair. Big strokes. I'm using chalk, cover a lot of ground this way. And she's a great character. Oh, I love it. How about some radiating lines like this, because she's a superhero and she's going to save the day. All right, now let's do it. Uh-oh. It's time for the pun. Okay, let's do the pun. And you know what a pun is. It's an illustrated gag. And it's a natural for cartooning because it has two meanings. This is, that's right, corn on the cop. Okay, I guess that makes him a colonel. You know what? You're going to have to remove my appendix soon. Sorry. I quite agree with you on that one, too. No problem. We'll move on. All right. This next thing I'd like to show you with heroes is something that I see on my travels. And it's something that I used to do, and a lot of people do this, and I'd like to show you how to do it right. And that is the features of a face. Now, I'm going to show you the bad way. I don't like to draw bad habits, but I'm going to do it anyway just to show you how to correct it. Now, here's what I see a lot of. People draw footballs for eyes like this, and then just put a circle in it where you see the whole circle or an oval like that with a black dot, and the eyebrow is just this like thin line. And for the nose, the same thickness on both sides, and they make the nostrils and come down, and it doesn't quite look natural, does it? And the lips, they draw the upper lip, connect the line, and they draw the bottom lip, and it just doesn't look natural. Now over here, I'm going to draw it the way you should do it. And you know what? The good news is, friends, it's easier than you think. You're making it too hard. That's the top part of the eye, and here's half the draw for the eye itself. That's the eyelid line. This is the eye. So you leave a little bit of white space, and that's all you have to do. Yeah, if you want to put a line on the bottom, you can, but just make a couple light lines like that. And now for the eyebrows, make a statement. You know, don't just draw a little light line like that. Give it some expression. Now for the nose, well, one side has to have a heavy, bold line. And on the bottom, you have to make that heavy because it might cast a shadow because it sticks out a little bit. And here's the nostril. But on this side, just a hint of it. Now if you want to put another line on, fine, but very lightly like that. Now, for the mouth again, you're making it too hard, folks. Watch. Upper lip, like that. And that's it. Maybe the corners of the mouth. And there you have it. Now, that looks a lot more natural, I think. So practice that. Okay? Now, let's create a panel of a comic book. And we'll lay out two characters interacting in the same panel. First, I'll draw a big square. This is actually the panel. That's what it's called. That's the terminology. Okay, now what we're going to do is I'm going to pencil this one in. And I'll put a character right here, and this is going to be Hero Guy. I'll make his head like that. And he's looking off this way, so I'm going to put his guidelines in just like that. Now let's put his neck in. Back of his head comes out like that. And his shoulders, and then his deltoids, which are real big. And here's a little bit of his chest that you just see a little bit. Here's his cape. Now, and here's his emblem. We'll go here, and it would say Hero Guy. Okay, now let's put the features in just like that. Now, I have a friend, Jose Delbo, who's a great comic book artist, and I met him, and he was telling me about the pencil stage, and he pencils it in. If he knows the inker, now the inker is a person who obviously puts the rest in either a dip pen or a marker, and if he knows the inker, he doesn't have to do detailed penciling. In other words, the inker, his friend, might know exactly what he was looking for. But if he doesn't know who's going to be inking it, and in comic books, what they have is like an assembly line, and sometimes you don't know exactly who's going to get it at the next point of the stage of the production. For instance, it might be an inker you never met before. Well, then you have to give him precise penciling. So I'm the inker in this case, and I know exactly what I want, so I didn't do real detailed. I just laid it out. Now let's put the nose in, and he's done some great comic book art. He's worked for all the major comic book companies. Now, for his expression over here on this character, I'm going to have it kind of scowling a little bit. Now, it might look like an angry pose under normal circumstances, but in this case, within the context of this frame, he's actually determined, and you'll see why in a moment. Okay, remember, just a little line underneath there maybe, and let's draw the outline of his face. Strong chin like this, look at that. And a jawline down here, and here you've got some strong cheeks. And right along the line of this bottom of the nose, you've got the ear and his hair. And you're not going to see the whole thing because some of this thought balloon, actually, he's thinking, and these little bubbles tell you he's doing that. I'll be covering it. So here's his hair. And now let's put his neck in. And let's put a little shadow over this. And his collarbone. And the cape, and a big muscular deltoid. That's a deltoid. And Hero Guy. You know, when you're creating a comic book hero, you have to create the supporting cast for your story. And there are people like the gruff but good-hearted police commissioner that's in every story. You have to have him. Okay, now back here we're going to have a woman, an older woman, like a grandmother type, and her head is facing down because she's crying, and she's crying because the bad guys have taken her grandson. It's pretty sad stuff, isn't it? And here's her chin, and she's a supporting character here. And a good way to create supporting characters is to just draw different types. And when you do that, you'll get an idea of what they look like. That's a good way to do it. But another way to do it is sometimes you need an idea before you draw. So ideas bring about drawings, and drawings bring about ideas. Let's have some tears coming out. And have that on her face like that. And she's sobbing. It's getting sad now. And here it says, I've got to find her grandson. And this is just one panel within a whole comic book story. And that picture tells a whole story in itself. Now, speaking of storytelling in this form, for our feature of the day, let's go to the International Museum of Cartoon Art and visit with the grandmaster of storytelling, Mr. Will Eisner. Stay tuned. My guest today once said that storytelling is society's way of explaining life. I like that. And his method of storytelling is something called sequential art, betterly known as comic books. And no one, and I mean nobody, does this better than my special guest today. He's the master, actually pioneered graphic storytelling, and he's taught it in art schools, books, and he's influenced a whole generation of artists. And he's also known for creating The Spirit, which is now considered a classic. And he's written several other graphic novels. And if you do yourself a favor, you can learn from it and, of course, enjoy it, too. Now, the list goes on, and I'd like to introduce him to you right now, the great Will Eisner.
Glad to be here.
Welcome
Glad
to the show. Here. Yes, oh, this is great. Well, as I said, you created The Spirit, and you've developed the sequential art as a storytelling medium. Could you tell a little bit about that and what that means?
Well, sequential art is nothing more than the arrangement of images in a sequence to tell a story.
Okay.
It's one of the oldest forms of written communication known to man.
Okay.
Began in the caves, went on up until they began, it originated language with the hieroglyphics. Mm-hmm. The Egyptian hieroglyphics were a form of graphic storytelling.
Now, which has come first? So we're saying words or the pictures? Do we know exactly?
I believe, and I'm not an anthropologist, but I think I can get some support from anthropologists that images came first.
Uh-huh.
Words are a result of the condensation of images.
Because I notice in your work, there's a lot of images without words, and that explains the story, and that can go for a good many panels.
We communicate, and we learn, and we communicate, and we receive from images more quickly than we do from words themselves, because we have to take a word, for example, the word run. You have to take that word, digest it, and translate it in your mind, and decide whether it's a small river, or somebody running, or a run in a stocking, or something.
Sure. In other words, you're doing the drawing in your mind, as opposed to seeing it.
Well, what I do is I use the image to tell the story, to convey the idea, deliver a message.
Right. Oh, great. Well, could we start with The Spirit, and could you tell us a little bit about his origin, and, you know, why he came about, and a little bit about him?
In 1938-39, a newspaper syndicate came to me and said, would I create for them a weekly comic book insert for Sunday newspapers that were very concerned about the fact that they were losing readers, young readers, to the newly popular comic books.
Okay.
In those days, they were called comic magazines.
And this was what year now?
This was
1939. Okay.
Well, I was very interested because at that time I was working in comics, and I wanted to leave what I considered at that time the comic book ghetto. I was really not interested in doing that kind of stuff. I wanted to do adult stories. I jumped at the opportunity because newspapers provided me with an adult audience. Sunday newspapers gave me, you know, father and mother and so forth. So I created a detective, city detective character, a freelance detective. Well, the syndicate called and said one afternoon, how are you coming on this thing? And I said, well, I've got him. I think he's going to be a handsome guy with a classic face and so forth.
They said, does he
have a costume? and I said, well, do we really need a costume? They said, gotta have a costume because
that's the gimmick.
What we can sell. We can't sell anything just ordinary like that. So I put a mask on him.
That's interesting.
And then they said, well, what else he got? Well, I said, well, he's got blue gloves. They said, well, that sounds all right. Go with that.
Okay. So they didn't say, all right, what else? And what else? No, they stopped. Let you stop
I had
there.
No intention of making him what you call today a superhero.
Mm-hmm.
In those days, we called them costume characters.
Okay, so that's interesting. He's not a superhero, although he may look
mortal.
Like one.
But he's very mortal. the superheroes are characters that are the mythological characters who are impervious. They, nothing can happen to them. The spirit gets beaten up. It's cost me more to get new clothes for the spirit than it has anything else. So
by not having a superhero kind of character, there was more ways that you could get a story in it as opposed to just bing, bam, boom,
when you have action. When you have a character that's mortal, it provides you with story. Something can happen to him. Now, what I'm drawing here now is a spirit in action. He's usually struggling with small-time thieves and crooks. One of the characteristics of the spirit stories was that he never really was involved with people who were going to change the orbit of the Earth or destroy whole civilizations. He was usually after some small-time crook because the spirit's territory, his turf, was big city.
Mm-hmm.
And as a matter of fact, my interest always has been big cities because big cities are a place where you can tell stories, with hundreds of stories.
Like, for instance, you said to me when we were speaking earlier, you said that if you went to the post office, you might see two fellows on a park bench.
And exactly. A lot of my stories in the spirit came from riding in the subway. When I started working on the spirit, I lived in the Bronx. I used to come down to my office, and riding in the subway, you have hundreds and hundreds of characters with stories behind
them. Remember, there used to be a television show, The Naked City?
Naked City.
8 million stories in The Naked City, meaning New York.
They were right.
They were right.
They were 8 million. There are 8 million. To this day, there's still millions of stories.
And how many episodes are there of The Spirit?
The Spirit started in 1940, June of 1940, in the Philadelphia Record, and ran weekly, complete 16-page, 8-page story in a 16-page supplement.
I see, okay.
Every week for 52 weeks a year. And when I was in 1942, I was drafted into the Army, and I had to turn the strip over to two assistants. One of them was Jack Cole, who later created Plastic Man.
Plastic Man?
Yeah.
Okay.
And
I would see right through that character, you know? I don't know.
And it continued until I got back from the Army where, late 1945, when I took up the spirit again.
Were you happy with the results of the way it was going while you were gone? Were you chomping at the bit from where you were and saying, boy, I wish I'd have done it this way or he'd have done it that way?
Well, the thing about this business is that each artist works at his own rhythm and creates his own good thing. So it was very good for them. It wasn't good for, wasn't me.
Mm-hmm.
When I got out of the Army, I had also had grown up, and my stories were no longer fantasy stories. They were more real life, slice of life stories.
Mm-hmm.
And so
I noticed when you work, you have heavy drama and mystery and large black areas, and you use them very well to make your story effective and create a mood.
Well, people's moods respond to light and dark.
Mm-hmm.
We, as primitive creatures, are terribly afraid of the dark because we don't really know what's happening there. Mm-hmm. And so I use shadow, as all artists do, to create drama.
For instance, on this picture right here now, if the light was hitting it from a certain light
source. First of all, shadow is a result of a flow of light.
Okay.
A direct flow of light. So that if light was coming from this direction here, which is probably the case here, I would probably put some shadow here. I'd put shadow here to create an image of mystery and drama. And then instead of having this fellow in the open this way, I would add some shadow to him here.
Okay. And his hat was probably a great way to get
His hat would be
casting a shadow on his face.
His hat would be in shadow and would cast a shadow on his face here.
They all wore hats in the 40s, didn't they?
Yes, they did.
Yeah. Now they wear baseball hats, and how do they wear them?
Well, with the beaks backward. I never could figure out why. What I've done here is created a shadow which would enable you to get the feeling of great light coming.
Yeah, that looks great.
There's a way of creating a mystery by running a shadow from below. Light coming from below creates a sense of mystery.
Yeah, that's like when you take a flashlight and you put it up in your face and try to scare somebody.
Whereas light from above gives you a total image of everything that's going on, so you kind of feel safe, you know?
Yeah.
It's like, you'll notice that when people are terrified, their eyes open wide.
Yeah, yeah.
And the reason they open their eyes wide is because they can see everything.
Okay.
So to protect yourself, so it's
so you
very
can be aware
primitive.
Of what's going on.
We're
yeah.
still very much primitive creatures.
Well, Will, I tell you, I could talk to you for probably the next 3 years, but
so
we're out of time right now.
Exactly.
And I want to thank you so much for coming.
Delighted to talk with you.
Now, your book, as I said, Sequential Art, is a whole course, by the way. If anybody wants to learn about this, this is the book. And also, there's another one, Graphic Storytelling.
Graphic Storytelling, which is a kind of a sequel to it.
Okay, well, I'd say do yourself a favor and get those books, and you learn a lot about this. And again, I want to thank you so much for being here. And you at home, stay tuned now for Cartoon Doodle Tricks. Thanks again, Will.
Good,
this is
wonderful.
Great. Look at this. Oh, this is fabulous. Okay, now today's doodle tricks are going to be hand and feet cartoon. And I'd like to welcome my friends. Hi, guys. How are you? Good?
Good.
All right. Now, the first one we're going to do is, well, you know what? I'll ask. Anybody know how to do the Boy Scout salute?
I do.
How's it go, Samantha?
Like this.
Okay, three fingers up. All right. I'm going to draw that. Okay, here's the pinky. And then the thumb wraps around like that. And then three fingers up. All right. Now, with a little bit of detail, make a line straight across like this, and a circle right there for an emblem, and some dots in there for eyes. This can be a nose, and a big smile, and some ears, and we got the Boy Scout himself. And you know what? We'll put a neckerchief on him. Pretty cool, huh? Like that one?
Yeah.
Okay, I got another one for you. Now this time, I'm going to draw another hand, and I'm going to have it pointing this way. And here's the thumb. And these fingers are bent back. One, two, three. Now, did you ever hear the expression, a bird in the hand is worth two in the bush? Well, here's the hand. And if we turn this drawing on its side, we can make the bird. Now, it's not in a bush. Actually, it's on a perch. And we'll turn the fingers into the feet, and this will be the perch. And an eye right here, looking at us, and some wild feathers in the back. And it's on the perch, and some cartoon effects and accessories, like it's swinging. And there you have it. You like that one?
Yeah.
Okay, I like that one too. Okay, now I got another one for you now. Okay, now I'm going to draw a foot. Now here's a foot from some poor guy who stubbed his toe and it made him cry. And it hurt so bad and it got all red. It made him very sorry that he got out of bed. But the story gets worse from what I'm told, because this poor guy even caught a cold. Achoo!
Achoo!
Like that?
Yeah!
Okay, well, that's all the time we have for today, and I hope you've enjoyed it at home, and I hope you guys liked it. Now, for our tip of the day, art is an adventure that never ends. That's me with a pith helmet on a cartooning safari. I'm Bruce Blitzing. Thanks for being with me today, and help me out, guys.
Keep on cartooning.
Just like that.